So, well, if you have any doubts regarding the last week's session, please put forward. Last week means, I suppose, on the Friday session, we had a recap of the previous weeks before the summer vacation. Whatever the topics we had a discussion, we had a quick look on those particular topics. And of course, it is not a very elaborate one, but it's just a brief overview, a kind of stuff for you to recollect the concepts or the ideas and the basic philosophy of IoT application deployments. So, any queries or any doubts regarding to this previous class discussion? The class is silent, then I presume that I can move forward. So, coming to the next topic, we have something called as a solution frameworks for IoT applications. So, this is as per the syllabus, I'm moving forward. So, if you look here, this is a solution framework for IoT applications. That is, we are now entering into IoT application development phase where you can understand how the things are getting realized, in the sense that how things are getting connected and how the data is being extracted from the things. So this is a topic where this is like in heart of the IoT application itself. So the entire unit has got a more importance on the IoT application development. So please try to focus on this particular unit, then you'll be very ease at the later stage. So this, what are the different solution frameworks that are available for us in the market, which will help us to deploy our IoT themes or IoT applications? Basically, most of the organizations and the industries, they want to realize or they want to go for an IoT concepts, and they want to go for a kind of automation for their particular services and for their particular applications to run along with the IoT concepts. So most of the today's market trend is like that. There are so many companies, of course, I can say companies, or you can call it as some kind of frameworks, which are already available in the market. Of course, some of them are commercialized and some are open source and some are community based. So, of course, some are both, to some extent, they are community-based. Community-based means for a scientific community, they can give certain privileges, certain access to some features of IoT developments, and those deployments can be carried forward. And some, they will put some restrictions. So, because they want to run their businesses, they will put some constraints on the cost and the limitations and so on and so forth. So let us just quickly have an idea what are the existing frameworks or the solutions, in other terms, the companies and the universities, of course, and other organizations which are providing us for to develop and to deploy the IoT for various use cases. So here, when you see a framework, please remember a framework which involves an end-to-end solution. When I say end-to-end solution, in business terminology, an end-to-end solution means from starting till the ending, starting from the user requirements till the user gets what he wants from that particular domain or from that particular application. So all the end-to-end activities are being supported by most of the frameworks. Some frameworks or some solution providers don't have the end-to-end solution to be delivered. So we'll see some of them which do certain kind of development and as well as deployment stages. So this IoT itself is having a network of devices which are connected to the internet, of course. Most of the applications, they do require the internet, and some of those applications which doesn't require the internet will be basically on the edge computing and to some extent on the fog computing. So Basically, this network of devices, when they are interconnected, we have transferring the data. So you are going to collect the data. You collect the data from various devices, and you transfer the data across those devices, and you are trying to infer some meaningful meaningful data, or to get the meaningful information from that data to make some wise decisions. So the IoT framework do have certain kind of features. The features will be, the framework should have certain features, such as if you see here, the most important feature is on the implementation of the device integration. How a IoT device is integrated into the solution framework. Solution framework means a framework which consists of so many components which will allow us to collect the data, process the data, make some decisions from that, or make some inferences from the collected and the processed data. So here, yes, please. Any query? So implementation of device integration, most likely for any IoT framework, is going to be the starting point. It means your physical devices, the devices which have been connected to your environment, the devices which you are making use to collect some environmental information, or the devices which you are making for your application to make some wise decisions. So all those devices are going to be in the lower level, or you can call it as the lower end, which tries to collect the data or the information with the help of sensors, and which will try to act accordingly with respect to the programming logic, with respect to that application which you are going to deploy for various use cases. So device integration is the most crucial part. Then followed by, once the devices, the physical devices along with your smart components, or your, both together we call it as a smart devices, where your physical devices, it can be any physical object. Physical objects means, once again I reiterate, it can be an electrical or a non-electrical object which you are going to use it in your application, or which you are going to use it in your smart home, or your smart agriculture, or your transportation, anywhere, any kind of application where you are going to realize it and understand that application in a better way, we are using certain devices. So along with the devices, you have certain smart integrations too. So once this smart devices have been integrated or been interconnected, then you try to acquire the data from those smart devices. That's basically you have smart acquisition or data acquisition. So how best we can collect the data and do process the data and store the data. So in order to do this, integrate the devices, collect the data and do some processing and store the data or process, you can store the processing data or you can store the raw data itself. So all these kind of storage mechanisms and collection mechanisms do incorporate certain authentications and authorizations. Those authentications will help us to have certain kind of confidence of from where the data is coming, and from, is it a secure device, or it is a data which is coming from a hacked device, or a data which is coming from an unreliable resource, something like that. So we'll also incorporate certain authentication and authorization of devices. So we start understanding how to integrate those devices in the today's session. So before we try to understand the device integrations, let us quickly have what are all the frameworks there are available in the market for us to develop and deploy our IoT applications very easily. So here you have a list of IoT frameworks. I just listed on, not only this, the list which I provide, there are plenty of other frameworks do exist on the internet. So you can also browse them. But what I listed is some of the known and of course most widely used by most of the companies and other business organizations for their IoT applications to be easily developed and deployed. So we have one particular framework called as CAIoT. You can just search this IoT on the website itself. You will get the information. So This car IoT, this is basically a car project. Of course, it has got two different plans. So you can see here, you can make this particular platform or your framework easily integrate your industrial applications. So if you see this, some of those customers of this one, you can see the use cases in agriculture, automotive, consumer electronics, healthcare, industrial IoT, logistics. There are certain use cases. So they already had their framework to be, they have designed it in such a way that they can easily support these kind of applications. So this is one cloud platform. Of course, these are all depending on the internet connections. They do work. And you can just have a quick overview about what this particular cloud platforms. So this is basically an IoT platform as a service. They do give these services for various applications. So these are all, they can be customized easily. And of course, if you see their use cases, please go through those applications in the real scenario, what they are doing and how they are trying to achieve those performances and how they are going to, how they are helping to the various business organizations. So you can just try to browse it and you can just have a quick look on this one. That is one particular framework. But remember, of course, this is an open source Internet of Things cloud platform. They do charge. So there is a pricing tag for almost what are the features you are going to hit. The advantage is you can have a number of devices connected. That's what they claim. And of course, it supports the interoperability, what the Internet of Things itself is requires. So like this, this is one IoT framework which will help you to prepare your IoT applications very easily. Similarly, Cisco has also has got a cloud network. It has also has a cloud platform. So basically, the Cisco, if you look here, they emphasize on the networking concepts and the networking of devices very high. In the sense that they provide the connections which are very robust and automated and they are highly secure. For any IoT enterprises, they would like to realize it. Similarly, you have Zeta IoT. This Zeta IoT is one particular platform, the framework. Basically, it is based on the REST. Can you please tell me what does REST stands for?
Representational state transfer.
Yeah, representational state transfer. So, what is mean by representational state transfer? Please, can you a little bit further narrow down still? Anyone can please try to respond. This REST you already studied in your computer networks, in your internet technologies, and maybe in your web technologies or other courses too. This is not a new, even in our course also, we several times we refer to this REST. Representational state transfer, RE, representational S transfer state transfer. What is this REST? Yes, please. Anyone? Which protocol is a RESTful protocol? Just give me a protocol name at least. A RESTful protocol. Hello.
HTTP.
HTTP, Hypertext Transfer Protocol. So, what does the HTTP protocol is used for? Yes, please. Please come on, please, just to have some interaction and to make it active. I'm just asking the old questions only. What is the use of HTTP protocol? Everybody uses HTTP protocol. What is the purpose of that? Hypertext. What is the hypertext transfer protocol, please? Yeah. Don't want to give any answers?
Sir, a pattern of request and responses.
Yes. So whenever you try to see, this is a very basic question. Everybody should know, even it is irrespective of this IoT course itself. Please remember. So don't confuse, you should not forget this REST, what is the RESTful and all. See, most of the time you are entering something here, HTTPS, So you are trying to get some information here. HTTPS, suppose I am entering something like this, HTTPS uohyd.ac.in. So whenever you enter this URL, https://uohyd.ac.in. So what is that being shown to you? What is actually done by your HTTP or HTTPS, whatever it may be? Just very simple, one or two lines answer, just in one or two lines, please. I'm not expecting any technicalities, but at least the meaning should be there in that one or two lines. Yes, please. When you enter something on your URL, you know, uniform resource locator or your address where you are going to type. See, you are typing. I hope you are able to see my screen.
Yes, sir.
Is my screen visible to you? Yeah. So see here on the address bar, I am typing https://uohyd.ac.in. What happens here, please, when you type this, when you type means when you enter this and you press enter key on your keyboard, what happens?
We request page to the server.
You request the page to the
server.
So what, yes, so you request the page to the server means, what is that request to the page to the server goes? It means you are sending, you are requesting some information, and that request information you are going to get it from a web server which is located at some computer on the internet. So University of Hyderabad, this website, that website contains several pages. So please see, this address, you can go to your developer tools and go to your network and see what commands are getting executed and what are the different things that is happening on your request. So please don't forget all these things. So once you enter here, uohyd.ac.in, and you press enter, see so many things, you can see it on the right side of your screen, and so much of information is retrieved from that particular website. How much time it has taken, and what are the images, and what are the contents and all, you can see it on the right side of your developer window. I can maximize and show you here. Just see here carefully. So you can get the status, you can see the protocol and what is that. Everything, once again, I'm just typing this uohyd.ac. Again, you can start it from the beginning. See here, now it is, some data is coming here with your scripts and all, which is related basically to your web page only. So you have some images, you have some contents and all. These are being retrieved from a web server. Please remember. From a web server. So what are the basic commands of this REST architecture, your REST protocol? You have HTTP GET, you have, yes, please tell me, GET, POST. Yeah, GET, POST. What are your CRUD commands?
Put, delete.
Yes, put, delete.
Very good. GET, POST, put, delete.
Yes, please don't forget, these are your REST. Today we are going to discuss on REST protocol only, everything. For the next another half an hour also, I'm going to discuss on the REST. So please recollect all your REST topics here. So what this particular Zeta IoT, so in your IoT, you are connecting your devices, but those devices are going to be interacted. Those devices are getting those devices are made to act like using your REST protocols, using your servers, the web servers and other, using APIs, we will try to interact with those IoT devices. So Zeta IoT is also another framework which will also provide so many solutions for our IoT developments as well as deployments. So you can see each and every framework what I am trying to mention here, you can go through that. They have their own websites. So this is basically Ka framework. You have, similarly, you have other websites here. Zeta IoT, you can go through the Zeta IoT. So an API first Internet of Things platform. This is basically, Zeta is an API platform. So what is API? What is API, please? API stands for Application Programming Interface. So every hardware device, every unit that you use it in your IoT can be made like an API, and that API will allow you to interact and allow you to collect the data. So that is being done by this Zeta IoT. And of course, this is a community open source. Please remember this Zeta is basically an open source cloud platform, which will allow you to install your integrate, your data collection, everything is done with your REST APIs, WebSockets, and React programming. Like this is one another solution framework. So similarly, you have Device Hive. Device Hive is another open source platform, basically which runs on your distributed computing environment. So Device Hive, you can see, go to the Device Hive IoT platform. Then again, you can go through that particular website, Device Hive. So here, of course, this is a pricing is involved in this one. It is not that much actually freely to be used for. So each and every solution framework, and this one Device Hive, there are differences between those solution frameworks. What I am trying to say is, so there are so many frameworks: Car IoT, Cisco, Zeta, Device Hive, Oracle IoT, SAP IoT, Microsoft Azure IoT, Google Cloud Platform, IBM Watson, Hewlett Packard Enterprise IoT, Amazon Web Services, OpenHabian, open source one. Another one is the OpenHabian. So each of these frameworks are basically helps the industries. Means based on the industry requirements or based on the user requirements, different platforms are more suitable for different applications. So it is not that one particular solution framework is enough for solving so many user requirements. No. So different, like Microsoft, they look for Microsoft products to be considered in their IoT applications. So that's why Amazon, Web Services, that is again Microsoft Azure solutions, they look into that aspect. Some SAP IoTs, they look for the financials, the SAP platform itself, for financial applications, basically for the banking applications. So Google's cloud platform is also there. Of course, this is to open source to some extent, but not all services can be easily realized. Similarly, IBM Watson, to some extent, they have been open source to give some features to the users. So like this, please go through all these cloud platforms. So I have just listed out some of those platforms. Anyway, we will go through some of those examples in the coming days, at least for the next 2 weeks on the third unit. So we will be using some of these platforms. Along with this, I will be using the other frameworks too for you to get more exposed to different set of IoT frameworks. So here, if you look here at the Device Hive, please look here carefully, because the Device Hive itself is basically on the REST and the API programming and the communication protocol. So you'll have a dashboard panel where it will help us to have the user interactions. And internally, these are the services. Of course, you have the MQTT protocol, the connectors, and the Device Hive front-end services and the management depending on this. So you have a Kafka message broker, a distributed computing environment where the real stream of data. So in the real time, you can get the stream of data, which is a continuous stream of data. So for some of the devices, there needs to collect the data continuously. So this message broker, Kafka, is one particular service. It will help us to continuously collect the sensor data, which is in a continuous manner. Can you tell me which particular sensor data is to be continuously monitored? Just any one particular sensor or any one sensor which flashes into your mind right now. A sensor data that needs to be continuously monitored or continuously be collected and to be understood and to make some wise decisions quickly. Can you name a sensor that is to be monitored continuously? Hello. Sensor. There are so many types of sensors, Amma. A gaseous sensor. If you are putting a gas sensor, either MQ2 or your MQ135, a gas sensor. Suppose in your home, you want to monitor your liquefied petroleum gas, LPG gas, from your kitchen, whether there is a gas leak or not. So that particular sensor has to be continuously collect the data from that sensor. So suddenly, if there is a gas or a smoke in the home, a smoke sensor. So these sensors, basically, they are need to be continuous. You cannot say at certain intervals of time only you need to collect the data. Suppose you are trying to collect the data from the temperature sensor of your home. You need not collect the temperature sensor of your room continuously or your home continuously. Continuously for every second, you need not collect the temperature sensor. So temperature will not vary significantly in every second. Please wait. Every second, there will not be any change. So there will be a gradual change. From morning till afternoon, there will be a gradual increase. From afternoon to evening, there will be a gradual decrease and further decrease in the night times. So there won't be abrupt changes in the temperatures when you monitor in your homes or humidity, something like that. But for our gases sensors, if they have been deployed in your smart homes or your industry or your smoke sensors, they need to be collecting the data continuously. That's why they need to be monitored. So when you are incorporating that kind of sensors in your IoT applications, those data has to be continuously monitored, and the softwares which collect the data, those software units, those are all yours. That's what this Kafka is, a software program, basically, which collects the real-time continuous stream of data. So that's what this particular device have, this particular one framework, which will always help you to collect the data very correctly and very accurately. That's what they claim it. And of course, this device have will work with the concepts of your REST APIs, application programming interfaces, your web sockets, and other communication protocols. Similarly, you already started practicing using the ThingSpeak. So what is the advantage of this ThingSpeak? ThingSpeak also allows you to collect the data continuously. Of course, the internet connection is required for you. So it will take the live data streams, and they do get that analysis of the live data streams using the other MATLAB softwares which are available on the cloud to make some inferences. So that is what the ThingSpeak is going to do. So each framework has got its own set of features. Similarly, you have Thinger.io, which is also an open source and which is ready to go, which you can use it directly. So that the open source platform also supports your hardware devices to be integrated and with different communication protocols and with different microcontroller boards, so that your IoT devices, they can be easily managed and controllable. So this is the particular Thinger.io. You can go to that website and you can see more features available on this. So of course, I have given you just a brief points on the solution frameworks which are available for various IoT applications. So you can have a quick look on these websites, and you please make a note of this. Not only this, there are several others are also there on the internet, but at least to have an idea for you, you need to have a quick idea about this. Any doubts here, please, up to this point? Please go through the respective websites and you can get more information. But unless until you don't have practice on using one, at least one solution framework, either ThingSpeak or your Zeta IoT, you will not be appreciating much on the IoT itself. Any doubts here, please?
No, sir.
Yeah. Are you able to understand the points?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes, please. Yeah. So now let us go to the next topic: implementation of device integration. Please understand the words clearly. First, understand what is this topic is. Implementation of device integration. Device integration is what you are trying to integrate your IoT devices into a framework, basically. So how do you implement this? That is the point of discussion over here. So you have in your IoT, you have a wide range of devices. You have thermostats, you have your Fitbits, like your wearable devices, you have your industrial robots, and of course, so many other devices. So which the device-to-device communication takes place, which the machine-to-machine communication takes place. So like this, so many things will happen here. But how do you develop an application which will help you to interact with those devices easily? So that device integrations, and you can talk to the devices. You means as a user, not only a user here, it can be an application itself as a user, it can be a device as a user, it can be a commodity as a user, it can be a customer as a user. So a user can be anyone with respect to this IoT application. So a device can be a user, an application can be a user, a customer can be a user. So anybody can, of course, depending on the usability, you can make the device to interact with those respective users. So how do you make use of those devices very easily? Please remember, in order to develop this application, the IoT devices does not require the software engineers to become proficient with the device level applications. So most of the software engineers, what they do is, they will try to write the software, that is the programs, which we call it as application programming interfaces, APIs. So using this, this is what the latest trend is. In the olden days, people used to write individual programs and they connect to the internet and try to interact with those things. But let us try to understand how can you write APIs to make your devices to be managed and can be controllable by your applications as well as by yourself. That's what the point of discussion here. So IoT integration is all about APIs. Please remember, if you are very confident on the APIs, you can do wonders. So what is this API creations? How you can create an API? How you can write your own APIs to make the device to be usable or to be controllable or to be manageable? So the logical connectors that allow applications to communicate with each other's IoT interfaces, these are your APIs. They are nothing but the logical connectors. They are not physically, they are not physically supporting you, but they are logically helping you to connect various other devices and talk to each other and to realize some other decisions to be made quickly. So APIs expose data that enables those devices to transmit data to your applications, which are acting like a data interface. Please remember, APIs are nothing but the data interfaces. So those data interfaces, they are interfaces. Basically, they are going to act like an intermediary between different applications which share the data, which try to communicate the data. So they can allow your application to control the device and serve as a function interface. Please remember. So similarly, that's what there's a term called function as a service. You might have heard platform as a service, software as a service, infrastructure as a service. But later, there is something called FAS, function as a service. So your a device can be made to act like a function, and that device is going to do some service for you with the help of function as a service that you incorporate into the device. So this, how do you make this? So the REST API, let me just quickly go through. You can write your own APIs provided you have the knowledge and the skills of the concepts, skills and the concepts related to REST API itself. So how do you can, now let us see one example here. So we have our two Raspberry Pis that are connected online. So we will make one of the Raspberry Pi, we will put our REST API on the Raspberry Pi, and so that you can control that pins of the Raspberry Pi through your iPhone or your laptop or your desktop PC. If you are connected to the internet, you can remotely monitor as well as you can control those Raspberry Pi using the REST API that you have written on your own. So if you want to write your REST APIs for Raspberry Pis or for your Arduino boards or for your sensor devices, it can be any IoT device. Before you try to write your own REST APIs, please have a complete understanding on how to build REST web, how to build a REST web API on a Raspberry Pi in JavaScript. Let us see this particular example, and we will go to the on Friday class. We'll do it on the Raspberry Pi. So the steps which are to be performed, REST web API on the Raspberry Pi. Can anybody tell me how we can make a Raspberry Pi manageable and controllable using the REST web APIs, please? Can anybody brief me if you have any ideas?
Sir, like Raspberry Pi should be hosting a server, sir, and certain API keys will be there on sending.
Yes, so the basic concept. Yes, that is the basic. Yes, you are right. You are right. So here, let us. So what I expect is, yes. So is there anyone who is interested to make the Raspberry Pi to be manageable and controllable using the REST web APIs? We can do practically. So you can access our Raspberry Pis, which are online. Not only my two Raspberry Pis, I think another two Raspberry Pis. One is Anurag Raspberry Pi, and another is Bharadwaj Raspberry Pi, are also online, I suppose. So there are four Raspberry Pis available online. You can access any one of those Raspberry Pi and develop a program to access them. Can anybody is interested to do that?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So this is one very practical idea. And those who don't know what is an API and what is a REST API, so I have prepared some notes for you to have a quick look on these things. So let me just brief you quickly, and we will try to go for that building. How do you can make the Raspberry Pi with REST APIs? Have you understood what we are trying to do now?
Yes, sir.
Right. So in basic in internet technologies or your computer networks, you already might have learned about this REST. That's what in the beginning session I asked you, what is REST and what is it used for. So when you are sitting on a computer and this computer is connected to your internet, so basically whatever the request that you are going to put forward through your browser, you are going to put right some HTTPS UHYD.ac.in. So once that request is being made, that page request is made, it goes through your internet and goes to the web server where uhyd.ac.in, all the web pages are available here. And that responses are going to come from this web server, and that responses are going to be given back to your browser. So that the data is going to be seen on your browser, which you are sitting on the computer, which is across the internet. So this is how, this is what your web one in the initial stages of internet technologies. This is around 2000 to 2005 and 2010, of course, at the maximum. But later, when the client server architectures have come into picture, so here the client server architectures have come into picture with the help of the REST APIs. So there is something called application programming interface, so which acts like an interface between the requests and your responses that are to and from your servers. That will help you to communicate. These APIs will help to communicate, to fetch the data, and to get the dynamism. Of course, you can have your some of the features like asynchronous way of getting the data, that is using your AJAX technologies. That will also will give you the data very quickly, very fastly, rather than waiting for the a web server to respond like this. So whenever there are changes on the web server, automatically those updates will be quickly reflected on the pages which are being connected to that particular server. So that's what there are technologies like AJAX and RESTful APIs have come into picture. So from the beginning of web technologies, internet technologies, slowly this AJAX and REST APIs have come. Now, if you might have seen already, the present internet technology students, they may also know here. So whenever you put a request, so the request is something like, I want to fetch the data pertaining to a particular book. So what is that you are giving here? Can anybody tell me what is this command is basically doing? If our client application wants to get the ISBN of a book, the user knows the title. We might send our APIs server as an HTTP GET. So here, when you try to give this particular request, how you are giving the request, it means how you are getting the information from the web server. So you are using the JSON GET JSON command. So you are sending that to the web server, and that web server, you have a web page on the hierarchically stored at a particular level. It can be either in the books slash ISBN slash the corresponding data. So of course, from that particular web page or from that particular resource, you are trying to extract that data and you are displaying it on your browser console. So this is what basically HTTP GET method. Of course, you can use the HTTP POST if you are looking for the security aspect. But in simple terms, you can use this HTTP. And of course, HTTP has got different versions also. HTTP 1, that is a very old version. Then you have HTTP 2 and HTTP 3. So we are mostly using HTTP 3 at this current scenario. So now HTTP get method will always will help you to get so-and-so web resource, so-and-so web page, which is located on a server, which is across the internet. It means which is there on the internet on a server, and on the server it is located, that document is located at a particular place, and you are trying to retrieve that. Of course, this is basically using jQuery statement. A very simple jQuery statement is being used. Sometimes you may get something like this, errors. What does these errors indicate? So the errors will also be reflected with some code numbers, which you might have seen. Some web page, web document not available, a web URL incorrect, or something like the server is busy, or something like the server is not known the web document. So different commands or different messages that you see it on your browser as a responses that you get it from your internet. So those response codes also you might have known. So what does the response code 400 indicates, please? If you are going to retrieve a web page from a web server. Yes, please.
Bad request.
Response code 400 indicates a bad request.
Page not found. Sir.
Not found.
Yeah, 400, 404, basically those web documents are not available on your web server. What does the response code 200 indicates?
Successful.
Yeah, where the web resource or the document is available on the web page. That's what I have shown you just now previously. When your uh20.ac.in is been requested, you get a response here from your web page. You can see it. Once again, I'm repeating. You can see the response codes here. On you can go to your developer and you can see. You open your developer web page, more tools in the developer tools. Right now I'm giving the command uh20.c. Suppose I'm just typing wrongly here, uph20.ac.in. I wrongly typed the domain name here. So obviously here up. You can see it here, it is failed. But there is some other information that is data image based, there are 200, but uph20.ac.in is failed here. So the data PNG, that is basically, that's what you can see, that this site can't be reached, uph20.ac.in. So, but this image, what are you seeing? That images are being with the status 200. That is a response that you get it from your browser. Okay, let me just give you the correct URL, uohyd.ac.in. Once you enter the uohyd.ac.in, so now you get the statuses here, 200, some are pending, but they are being resolved. So the status 200 indicates that so many web resources, web documents, some pictures, some JavaScripts, and all those things which are available on the web servers are now are been rendered onto your browser, and you can see that's why the status is 200. But sometimes you get the status code 500, 400, 300. So these status codes are implies that those documents are not available. So our point of discussion is that why I'm trying to tell you all these things is, see this, when you get some response, you get a correct output. Of course, that output will have the certain status code too. And of course, sometimes if the so-and-so authorized persons are not accessing, then you get a bad authentication. Some websites and some web resources are also secured, where you can only authorized users can retrieve that information. When people are trying to share some information, so you can put some security onto those web resources too. So the same concepts, please remember, all these the concepts, whatever you're seeing, the CRUD operations, the create, read, update, delete, whatever you're using for the REST protocol or the RESTful, whatever the things, get, post, delete, okay, update, all these commands, the same concepts do apply for our Raspberry Pi also. Please remember here. So Raspberry Pi, this is a device, physically a device. This is basically Raspberry Pi, Arduino, or any other sensing device which you build it, which you design and fabricated it. So some devices, those devices themselves can be made as like this, please remember, this devices can be made like a simple program also. How you can make this device, the physical object, into a program or into an accessible software, that can be done through your APIs, please remember. So that's what the concept here is. So once you can make the device, so the devices can be easily integrated into your entire application, into a big application. Each device is nothing but a program. It is a code. So that program code can be easily interfaced. It can be easily interacted. In other terms, your Raspberry Pi, the Raspberry Pi has got components here. You have a GPIO pins. You have a Pi camera. You have another display device. You have a USB ports here. So all these GPIO pins, USB ports, your Pi cameras, or any sensor that is integrated to this particular Raspberry Pi can be easily manageable, controllable using a software programs across from the internet using your application programming interfaces. So using APIs, you can interact with your devices, IoT devices, which are deployed on the other side of the world. In other terms, that you are sitting on a particular in a country or in a particular place, so you can remotely manage, control, as well as you can use, collect the data of these devices with your application programming interfaces. How do you develop, how do you write these programs is what our point of discussion. Please, my emphasis is, please understand this basics here. So once you can understand how do you write your own APIs to interact with these devices, that completes the major part of our IoT development. So in order to understand this, you need to understand the basic concepts of what I told you, the REST and the REST APIs. So for the next class, I already uploaded these materials. So please go through it and recollect it, and we'll do the programming. How do you interact with this? How do you make your Raspberry Pi? So we have our Raspberry Pi. So we'll write our own APIs, and at least simple exercise like LED on, LED off from your mobile phone. Without using the thing, and like ThingSpeak, you use ThingSpeak, you made or designed your own GUI using Python programming. But now you are trying to do this using your APIs. Please understand the difference here, what we are trying to do. So of course, here, Raspberry Pi requires a web server to be installed. You can use Node.js web server. We can install the Node.js web server on this, or you can use any other web server, and accordingly you can write those programs. So I am taking one example here, Node.js as a backend server program onto the Raspberry Pi. And I will take the example of JavaScript here. But the same things can be done using your Python, if you are going for the Python frameworks, and you can, if you are going for other kind of different stacks, you can use those stacks if you are confident enough. So it is not that only using this JavaScript and Node.js can be done. You can do it with other examples, to other tool, other technologies too. So this is the material. So first we go through all this. So what we do is, on the Raspberry Pi, we will install our Node.js and along with the Express framework. Then you will write our index.htmls, and you write our JavaScripts to access this components on these devices here, and we prepare our API so that you, from your browser or from your mobile phone or from another system, the same, using your HTTP GET and your GET and PUT your responses, using the request, you can send similarly what you have used for HTTP in for your other web pages that are data to be retrieved from web servers. Same process will be applied, and you'll get the responses, and you can store those responses in a JSON format on your things. So this is the step by steps are there, and of course I will not complete, not be able to complete today. So the practical thing is left for you. Let us do this practical thing on the Friday session. A complete 2-hour session will be there, so that you can see these particular applications on that is one thing. And once you do this one, we have another exercise too. So that completes the this particular part of implementation. That's what implementation or device integration and data acquisition and the data collection. So once you collect the data, then how do we store it? Either in the cloud or in the device, that we'll see it in the next week onwards. So the coming Friday class, we'll see the practicality on these particular topics. and the next week we'll see the other topics. Once you complete this one, so this same process has to be applied for your either your smartphone, there's a home automation, or for your healthcare. I will take these two case studies, and we will try to see these two case studies. How do we do with this? With what are the devices we have? You can put these two case studies into practice with the help of these concepts. Any doubts here, please? Any queries? Dr. No. I see only 18 to 20, of course, 18 excluding me, it will be 17. So 17 of them are there on the session. Only 50%. Of course, 36 students are there here for this IoT. So may you know the reason why they are unable to attend it? Still, is there any problem for others to attend? Any idea? Anyway, I'll send a mail to them. Today, I will send a mail to all of them to start attending the classes. Yeah, anyway, I'll get the attendance from this sheets because the sessions are getting recorded. So Google Meet is after the session is completed, it will send the attendance who have attended these sessions and also I need not take it physically and attendance from here. So of course, attendance is not mandatory. But still, you need to just be regular so that you can be on the track of your studies. Any queries, please? The material is uploaded on the Moodle's page. So please go through that material and come prepared. And for the coming class on the Friday session, I am just keeping open to all of you. So whoever is interested, you can access the Raspberry Pi and complete this particular exercise, please. Any internet technology students, if you can do, then it will be a good practice for you. So just very two, three pages only here, not more than that. You can access our Raspberry Pi using your key. So let me just check whether it is on or not. Yeah, it is on only, so you can use the PuTTY to connect to this Raspberry Pi. Raspberry Pi is anyway, it can be accessible to you. And once you get access to this Raspberry Pi, you can develop your best API commands on this. So the port number is 18. You can connect to the Raspberry Pi. So start, you can deploy your Node.js server. So the Raspberry Pi, the basic diagram is available here. The application architecture is available here. You need to write these three programs, myapi.js, index.html, and myclient.js. Once you complete these three programs, you can access your Raspberry Pi. Even your GPIO pins can be accessed. So how to access the pins and all, that we will see it in the Friday's class. Am I clear to you, please?
Yes, sir.
Please let me know if you have any queries.
Sir, is the implementation PDF uploaded on Moodle?
Huh? Which PDF?
Like the one that you just showed, the implementation one.
Implementation of device integration into IoT application, it is there, no? No? Is it not there? One second. It is here. Is it not visible? Is it not accessible to you? Hello? Am I audible to you, please?
Yes, sir. Like this one, how to build a REST web API. Is this one uploaded on Moodle?
Ah, okay. I just put it on the separate page. Okay, one second. Yeah, please check it once, please.
Yes, sir, got it.
Yeah.